Welcome everyone, this is Tim Pohlman and you're listening to the SEP Couch. This podcast is all about standard essential patents. We talk about patent strategies, friend licensing, patent pooling, and patent litigation. So let's dive into today's episode. He is the Senior Vice President with Access Advance. I'm super happy having today Paul Bawel joining me here on my SEP Couch. Hi, Paul.
Hi, Tim. How are you doing?
I am great, and it's really good having you here. I would love to hear about you, how you know you came in touch with the world of standard essential patents, maybe to start with, before you also joined Access Advance. I know you had different positions. It would be great to learn about that and walk us through your career a bit.
Well, sure, Tim. Thanks. You know, I always start these things being a lawyer with just saying, you know, first, thank you for having me. But my comments are my own. They don't necessarily reflect the positions or policies of Access Advance, its licensors, its licensees, or you know, anybody else we might mention here today. So just, you know, come back and talk to me if you don't like something I say. But my professional career, you know, I started my professional career as an electrical engineer. You know, I worked for a small firm that specialized in research, development, testing, and evaluation in the field of underwater acoustics for the United States Navy. You know, after several years as an engineer, I decided to go to law school, and during law school, I took the patent bar. You know, after graduation, I began writing and prosecuting patent applications for General Electric's licensing business, and most of these patents related to digital video. You know, after about 3 years, I moved to General Instrument. You know, they designed and built cable systems. General Instrument was the primary architect of ATSC. They significantly contributed to the MPEG-2 standard, and they were an early adopter of MPEG-2. They were also one of the original members and owners of MPEG-LA. You know, at GI, I was responsible for building and managing their IP portfolios, and I managed their patent collectivities. While I was there, Motorola purchased GI, and at that point, I took over responsibility for Motorola for managing their pool activities as well. After several years at GI, I moved to Microsoft, where I was a divisional IP counsel, a divisional patent counsel. And over 9 years, I supported several of their businesses, including their Windows Media platform. This included Windows Media Video, Windows Media Audio, DRM, their media player, you know, and other assets in that business. You know, I also worked on business and legal issues related to licensing SEPs, you know, including patent pools. Between my time at General Instrument, Motorola, and Microsoft, I was responsible for managing the patent portfolios of several technologies with standard essential patents, you know, and working in the pools related to them. And this included preparing and submitting essentiality evaluations for all these pools. You know, these pools included MPEG-2, both MPEG-4 video standards, that includes AVC, HEAAC, HDDVD, BluRay, and some Wi-Fi standards. I joined Advance in 2015. I was one of its first three employees, and I spent my first five years here licensing HEVC, bringing in new HEVC licensors, and building that program. About 3 years ago, I started working on VVC, you know, identifying licensors, potential patent owners for SEPs. You know, much of you've done in your work, so we'd know who the primary players were in this area. You know, and then the last 2 years, I focused, you know, pretty much entirely on creating our new VVC pool and scalable licensing platform.
That is great, Paul. And maybe, especially on that last point, I think it would be great to understand from you a bit more. How, you know, why do we have maybe patent pools in the first place? And also, how do we have to look at the landscape of patent pools? If we look at the video codec generations, AVC, we had two pools, HEVC, we even had three pools. Now we're with VVC back to two pools. While there was some idea of trying to have only one pool, That has been discussed a lot in the industry, and I read a lot of opinions that, you know, more than one pool is somehow inefficient. But then after all, I think, you know, any aggregation should be efficient, right? No matter if it's one or two pools. And you have in the end also some outsiders, I may call them. So not everyone joins a pool, right? Can you elaborate a little bit on this? What was the journey maybe with VVC, and how was the pool formed, and what was the initial idea of forming a pool, and how did it end up being two pools maybe?
Well, let's start with, you know, just kind of why there are multiple pools. I think the challenges of getting everybody to agree on a single pool, you know, why there are multiple patent pools, you know, that's just different ways of asking the same question. And, you know, I think they have the same answer. Joining a patent pool is a long-term commitment that requires investment and diligence by a company. You know, companies have their own long-term business strategies and goals. You know, if they're going to join a pool, they've got to figure out how that pool complements, you know, those long-term strategies and goals. You know, those are, you know, goals and strategies, they're just very difficult for a company to change. So patent owners, they're going to join pools and form pools that reflect their long-term business interests. It's why there have been, and, you know, there are currently multiple pools for several technologies. I mean, think about Wi-Fi and cellular. Think about lots of technologies that there are no pools. You know, everybody just licenses on their own. You know, and why at least now there are at least two, you know, VVC pools, at least early on. We'll have to see what happens over time. You know, pools provide efficiency for the market, but there has to be compromise and a willingness amongst all the players in the market to make that happen. Now, I think it's possible for patent owners to compromise and form a balanced pool. And, you know, that's going to be successful over a reasonable time. But all the players have to have a broad understanding of all the issues for both patent owners and implementers. And there has to be that willingness to compromise. Now, early on, related to VVC, early in our efforts to license HEVC, implementers were telling us, you know, that multiple pools for generational video formats, it was just too burdensome to keep taking a license to each one. You know, pools needed to efficiently license related technologies. You know, at that time, engineers had already started developing the VVC standard, and the market was also telling us that early clarity around licensing terms was going to be important for driving the adoption of VVC. So about 3 years ago, we began working on a better pool product. You know, we spent 6 months talking to everyone that we could that participated in the market. We just asked very basic questions and listened carefully to their answers. You know, as we heard some common threads, we went back to the same people and we kept following up, getting more feedback and kind of trying to consolidate where there was going to be a road to agreement. You know, once we had that, then we held meetings with patent owners over about 16 months. You know, we started with what we learned and we worked through multiple proposals to get to what we have today. You know, we believe the patent owners in our program, you know, reached a reasonable consensus, and that includes from almost everybody that participated in our program. You know, they think it's balanced, and that includes those people who haven't yet joined us. You know, the terms and structure of our advanced pools are set, but we continue to listen and look for ways to improve our licensing programs. So I think it's a lot of work, and pools are there for the benefit. But the market has to be willing to think about it in terms of what's acceptable to everybody. You know, you got to offer under competition law basically the same terms to everybody who's similarly situated. And that doesn't always fit well with the current business interest of every program. So it just takes time for a well-formed, well-thought-out program to be accepted and take hold.
And if you form a pool, I'm sure it's still also a continuous activity to do that. So you launched now VVC, right? I read there's some benefit in being one of the early licensors to it. And you have some incentive scheme also to, you know, attract maybe other patent owners that haven't signed yet, right? I mean, you continuously add people to the pool, right?
Right, that's true. Yeah, we launched our VVC Advance licensing program last July, and, you know, we announced terms and invited VVC patent owners to join. You know, we offered some pretty significant incentives to licensors. And that included a premium on patent points for licensors that joined by the end of last year. You know, patent points determine how pool revenue is allocated to our licensors. You know, the patent point incentive is going to continue through June of this year, but it's slightly reduced at this point. You know, not significantly, but there's a little bit of reduction to it for people who join us, you know, for the next few months. The point incentive is for all licensors to join us by June 30th. And the thing that's really important is it extends to all their essential patents, you know, even those that issue in the future, and it lasts for the life of the pool. So it's a pretty significant incentive. We offer to defer the evaluation fees for a significant number of VVC patent evaluations that our licensors submit, you know, in the near future. But all of our licensor incentives are going to end on June 30th of this year. So we hope that anybody we're not talking with at this point will join us. And you're right, we continue to talk to everybody and work. I mean, if you consider our HEVC program, we started with 5 licensors and now we have 38. And our most recent licensor joined us late last year. I may be off slightly on that timing. Yeah. So I don't know. Did that answer your question or?
Great. No, I think it's very interesting to also hear. I mean, everything in a way is in flux and will remain in flux in a way, as you said, you know, there will be future patents. I mean, also the VVC standard is still improved and there's new versions and people are investing in R&D continuously. Then you have new people join. How does that work with contracts? Now, how, you know, there's, I think, two things to it. First of all, you have the royalty sharing rules within the SEP owners that are members of your pool, but then you also have licensees. Let's say 5 more companies join your pool. Will that increase the rate of VVC or will that remain stable? And if that remains stable, will the revenue sharing then change when new companies come in? Can you elaborate a bit on how you deal with all that flux of joiners and, you know, future patents to be filed, to be integrated, these kind of things?
Sure. You know, there's a couple things there. You may be referenced to, maybe you're different, bilateral licensing, you know, and that's an obligation to all, that all patent owners have to somebody who wants a bilateral license. You know, they have to license on FRAN terms and conditions. And that's separate from the pool, even if I'm not aware that it's really ever happened except in maybe the scope of big companies doing huge cross licenses. But, you know, if there's a licensor and licensee in the pool and the licensee still wants to come and ask for a bilateral license to a licensor, the licensor has an obligation to engage with that party. So we'll see how that works. Now, in terms of pools, you know, our terms are set and they're based on us getting to a certain amount of HEVC patents, a certain amount of the stack. And when we get there, you know, then the pool becomes a pretty good deal. And we set it pretty low. And right now we think we have about 25% of the stack of VVC patents. And we have for HEVC, we have over 70%. You can read our white paper for HEVC and we based our rates on 40% of the stack. As new licensors join, the rates don't change. So the pool just gets better for them as new licensors join. The distribution of revenue will change over to the licensors because, you know, you get new licensees and they're paying in, but now new licensors join and you have a lot more patents. When we started HEVC, we had about 500 patents. Patents were continuing to issue. New licensors join. We now have about 17,500 patents. Of course, we have a lot more licensees, so there's a lot more revenue to divide. But as that happens, if we had exactly the same licensors and didn't increase, but we had the same licensees, obviously there'd be a lot more revenue to distribute amongst them. You know, the revenue distribution is a little interesting. I mentioned that we do it on patent points, and patent points are assigned, you know, as patents are evaluated on a country by country basis to patents that are determined to be essential. And the first evaluated patent is going to get a bigger point amount than subsequent patents evaluated in a family. And there are only a certain number of patents in a family that we're going to give points to. So, you know, that's how patents are assigned points to allocate revenue. Then the royalty revenue from a licensed product, it's allocated to the country or territory where the product was sold or manufactured. You know, that's where infringement occurred. And then finally, the revenue for each country or territory, it's allocated to licensors based on a licensor's proportion of patent points in that country or territory. You know, here's a simple example. If you have $100 of licensing revenue we collect and it's allocated to Spain, and a licensor has 10% of the total points in Spain, the licensor gets $10. You know, that's pretty straightforward. The licensors put a lot of thought into this system, and they really like it because it provides a level of fairness to licensors. You know, it doesn't reward a licensor for filing a large number of continuations or divisional applications on the same invention. You know, it means a licensor can't collect more than a reasonable share of royalties for any one invention. You know, one thing that's important to remember that all the essential patents a licensor has the right to license are included in the license grant. You know, that includes essential patents that aren't on our patent list. And that means that there wasn't an evaluation, there were no points assigned, no revenue allocated. But if it was essential and it's in the license scope, you know, then it's included in the license grant. You know, so licensors are incentivized to file a reasonable number of patents within a family and to submit those patents for evaluation. It creates a stronger pool of patents and creates overvalue to both licensors and licensees. You know, if people want more details on this, they're welcome to contact us.
Great. No, that's really exciting. Just one follow-up question on that. You said you allocate points to patents. Does right. that mean a patent, let's say a US patent A, may have more points than a US patent B because it was found in determination to be, for whatever reason, more valuable? Or are typically patents from the same jurisdiction, let's say, treated similar?
Yeah, they're treated the same. We don't distinguish value other than, let me start. We look at a patent based on whether it's essential or not. And then we look at it based on what family it's in. And again, in past pools, there have been companies that would file hundreds of continuations and divisional applications to take a bigger share. Right. So we limit the number of points in a family by giving the first patent in the family evaluated a point, and a few more patents in a family get a fraction of a point. And then that for that country, that's all they get. They want to file more patents, that's fine. But you know, that's how what we mean is it's fair, and companies only get a reasonable amount of revenue based on any one invention, which is represented by a patent family.
No, that makes a lot of sense. Well, that's interesting. Another topic on pools, and you touched on this a bit. A pool is a contract and is a one-stop shop, which is great. But for whatever reasons, we have also situations in the market where a pool member may license bilaterally, right? And that still is possible. And also we may have situations where certain licensees are just not signing with you. How is that typically solved? Is Access Advance enforcing patents, or is it only the members that enforce? And are they then individually enforcing patents because, you know, licensees may not sign for their license? Or how is that in practice?
Yeah, Tim, again, we touched on this a little bit. You know, SEP owners, they generally have an obligation to license bilaterally on FRAN terms and conditions to any implementer that wants a bilateral license. You know, pools shouldn't, and we don't interfere with this. The parties to a bilateral license, they determine the terms and conditions between themselves. You know, and these may address technologies and address issues beyond what a pool can offer. You know, patent pools, you know, on the other hand, these provide licensees with the opportunities to take a single license to multiple licensors, you know, instead of needing to negotiate multiple bilateral licenses, you know, one with each licensor. And unlike what can be negotiated in a bilateral license, pools are generally only authorized to offer licenses in the form of a standard license agreement. You know, regarding enforcement, Advance has no authority or ability to enforce patents. We don't own any patents. You know, we spend the time to negotiate with an implementer, you know, working with us in good faith to address their issues and come to reasonable resolutions. But in some negotiations, you know, there comes a point where you know that the company is just not going to take that pool license. At that point, we refer that and we inform the licensors. You know, it's up to them at that point to go out and decide if they want to negotiate a bilateral license. You know, we feel the implementer also has an obligation to go to the licensors and ask for a bilateral license. And then it's up to the individual licensors to decide whether they want to enforce their patent rights if they can't come to terms. You know, and besides this, you know, a licensor can enforce its patents against anyone that's unlicensed as it chooses at any time, whether we're negotiations or not, and regardless of what we're telling them about how those negotiations are going. You know, I just want to add that when we are in negotiations and we give licensors information, there is a very strict level of confidentiality. So, you know, we're authorized to do a particular license agreement. It's pretty standardized, but we don't share any of the particulars with the licensors. We give them the general update about how it's going and if we think it's going to be a successful negotiation, and then they decide from there how to move forward.
Okay, now that's interesting. And I think you said that, you know, with an increasing number of licensees, of course, a pool or the number of licensees shows how successful a pool is, and the number of licensors make a pool more attractive because, you know, signing with the pool gives you access to much more patents. However, aside from all that, right, also the pool is very much dependent on how many companies actually use and implement the standardized technology. Right? How popular is VVC in the market? Mm-hmm. And I've seen also discussions on, you know, AVC being a very popular codec, HEVC not as much. And then, you know, the question now is how popular will VVC be? And some people argue the reason why HEVC may not have been as popular as AVC is due to the complex licensing. And I don't tend to believe that really. But I know, what is your opinion about that? What makes a technology or a video codec successful? And is it really that dependent on the SEP licensing?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. And you know, there's a lot of misinformation circulating about HEVC. You know, and it keeps getting repeated. You know, I think it's by a particular set of people who have an interest in other technologies maybe becoming more accepted. But you know, let's face it, I think, and I agree with you, I guess, if I understand you right, that HEVC is very successful. Let's just look at it from a historical viewpoint and you know, kind of a business viewpoint to some extent. You know, generally a new video format is going to take, you know, several years to become the primary encoding tool for new content, you know, because of the startup and ongoing costs to content creators and distributors. These are for-profit businesses, and implementing a new format has to be justified before they're going to do it. That generally happens when the video format is broadly implemented in devices. You know, let's compare some facts between AVC and HEVC a little bit. You know, VVC is really early, so we can't really say what's going to happen with that yet. We expect it's going to develop along the same lines as other video codecs. We'll just have to wait and see. But you know, HEVC has now been out for about 9 years. So let's just compare historically, like some things that have happened between AVC and HEVC. You know, both of them were implemented in chipsets and in devices on about the same time frame. You know, early in the life of AVC, it didn't have any comparable competing video formats, you know, until HEVC was developed. And today, HEVC is in almost every video-capable consumer device and in almost every video chipset that drives consumer devices, you know, and its 4K-capable competitors aren't. You know, some are coming, but they're not there yet. Another interesting point is, you know, annually since 2018, you know, that's just 5 years after the HEVC standard was finalized, you know, there have been billions of mobile phones, hundreds of millions of set-top boxes and surveillance cameras, televisions, PCs, tens of millions of gaming consoles, and you know, just many other devices and services that implement HEVC. You know, people complain that HEVC is, you know, it's just incremental. It doesn't really do much more than AVC. but this isn't true either. It's provides up to and oftentimes more than 50% bandwidth and storage reduction at the same resolution as AVC. And it supports features AVC doesn't: multi-view scalability, range extensions. It's expanded the color gamut available to the video compression significantly. And maybe most importantly, HEVC has driven 4K streaming and HDR content, you know, the services around those. This wouldn't have happened with AVC because AVC can't meet the bandwidth limitations for 4K UHD video in current data networks. You know, it took about 20 years for AVC to, or AVC's been around for about 20 years, and it took about 10 years for it to overtake MPEG-2 in content creation. And HEVC, according to Bitmovin, HEVC is now overtaking AVC in content creation. So I think, you know, to conclude that there's, you know, AVC is doing it, it's more successful or is better, you know, is just ignoring facts. You know,
okay.
So, you know, kind of on your question though about whether patent pools can hamper the adoption of standards, you know, I just say absolutely not. The opposite's true. You know, pools represent the most efficient means of licensing a broad portfolio of essential patents. You know, these patents are owned by many different patent owners and many different business interests. You know, they avoid the huge administrative burdens, you know, inherent to managing multiple licenses. So, you know, people who complain about pools, I think they're just doing it for their own business interest. And you know, they should, you know, just kind of pay attention to what's really going on and let the pools work for the benefit. If they don't want it, go negotiate bilateral licenses. That's fine. That's their priority to do that, or their privilege to do that. But don't interfere with those people who want to take advantage of a system that works very well for them.
Right. Yeah, and I keep also saying, I mean, two pools is not necessarily bad. It's aggregating licensors in any case. But let's talk about VVC then. I mean, that's the latest generation. It's early days, obviously, but I keep read a lot of good things about it. It's versatile, how the title says already. And we also, of course, are excited about some use cases that are new to video compression, maybe. When I talk about IoT and connectivity, people keep forget about video compression a lot of times, while it is in many applications. You can imagine, you said video surveillance. I mean, automated surveillance cameras. I read a statistic that in 5 years time only, we have more video content consumed by computers, not ever seen by humans. You know, just, you know, data that is video data that is put into automated systems. Any robot that drives autonomously will use a video, you know, compression technology to understand the surroundings. So there's everything, you know, every machine needs eyes, to put it that way. And that includes video compression. Can you elaborate on that? What do you see as a vision of VVC here?
Well, I think you've kind of just answered your own question. You know, video content's exploded over the last 10 years, and it's expected to continue over the next 10 years. And infrastructure by itself can't keep up. So codecs and future codecs, especially VVC now, which is expected to provide even 50% more, at least additional compression capability, you know, at same resolutions and storage capability. You know, it's a critical tool to improve video compression, you know, especially at those higher resolutions. And I think that as implementers work with VVC tools, you know, especially those that provide lower latency, you know, we're going to see many new uses that we don't yet know about. And the areas that it's already being used in are just going to get better. You know, I agree, cloud services, improved virtual and augmented reality, like you mentioned, machine-to-machine communication. These are just huge areas that are really in their early phases of development. And it's really important. You know, live stream gaming is starting to take off and replace, you know, gaming consoles. Automated manufacturing, automated driving, traffic control, medical applications. You know, the list just goes on and on. You know, we could sit here and probably spend all day coming up with new uses that are going to benefit from better video compression. You know, I think also that, you know, to be successful for VVC, it's going to require a licensing program that provides clear and transparent terms for implementers. You know, we've talked about this a little bit. Do pools or licensing inhibit the adoption? And, you know, and I think it can if it's not good and doesn't create a balance between the interest of the whole marketplace. But, you know, when you get licensors together and, you know, whether it's, you know, we'd like to have a primary pool like we do for HEVC, but even if there are two, you still have multiple licensors, you know, where you can go and get a lot of rights in various, very efficient transactions. You know, and this is going to benefit everybody. You know, when licensing provides balance and efficiency, it's going to accelerate the success and adoption of a new technology. You know, we think we've provided this for VVC with our platform licensing structure in the MCBA. It's going to be very important to the Internet of Things. You got to remember, like you mentioned, video is just a very significant component in many of those things that are the Internet of Things. And, you know, IoT is just increasing the demands on network infrastructure. So, you know, fast, efficient, and standardized video compression is going to be critical to IoT's future.
And is that also going to pose, in some ways, a challenge? I mean, it's great if everyone's using it, but there are now new players that may implement video compression technologies that you have to chase in ways of, you know, chasing these new licensees. These companies may not even be that aware of how SEP licensing works. You know, we've discussed many of these discussions also with 5G and Wi-Fi 6, for example. But you also see those challenges for VVC that you may talk to licensees that, you know, may not be really experienced in having these discussions in the first place. Is that something that you also foresee for your pool?
Yeah, absolutely. We've seen it for both VVC and HEVC. There are a lot of companies that weren't even around when HEVC was developed, you know, particularly in China, but not, you know, exclusively in China. You know, there are a lot of US companies, a lot of European companies. Cloud services are just, you know, companies pop up all the time. And so they, my experience, at least with companies, is they worry about the products and development and they go full force ahead. And licensing is kind of an afterthought. It's like, yeah, that's going to be a good problem to have if we get to that point where people are telling us you got to take a license. But, you know, it becomes difficult for them to adapt, again, those long-term business goals and strategies to a pool that maybe doesn't really address the way they've thought about building their business. And so, you know, this is an issue that we deal with a lot. We explain pools, we explain how licensing works, we explain how antitrust and competition law works with relation to pools. And, you know, when they say, well, we do it this way, so you need to give us these terms and you need to cut us these deals. And when we say, you know, we can't do that. We already have 50 licensees in you know, that are your competitors, and they've all taken a license in this particular way. And, you know, to give you those terms, that would give you, you know, an unfair business advantage. And that would be discriminatory and violate FRAND obligations. You know, so that's a lot of work where we spend a lot of time negotiating with people, and it's worth it to spend the time. The sooner people, you know, come to realize what it is, they start making better decisions with relation to intellectual property and figuring out how to manage their business and integrate it into their business decisions rather than making it an afterthought.
Right. And I think after all, if a pool does that work for the licensors, that's again the most efficient thing to do, because you gain your experience in talking to these new business models over time. You, as you said, you started it apparently already with HEVC. Very interesting. Maybe let's, in my last point here, Paul, let's touch upon some of the recent news that we read about HEVC Advance or Access Advance, but it was on the HEVC technology. And there was a recent litigation here in Germany with Vestel. And I think also here, some of the news were, at least to me in the beginning, not clear what that actually meant. And yesterday also, I read that, you know, Access Advanced, you know, due to that litigation, changed their licensing terms to be FRAND. Can you elaborate on this? I would love to hear from you really what happened there and, you know, what this is all about.
Yeah. Thanks, Tim, for the opportunity to address it. This is a good question. You know, there's quite a bit of misinformation circulating, you know, about this decision. And, you know, that's kind of interesting because the court's decision hasn't even been published yet. But giving the court its discretion to publish it when it's ready and the respect to not comment too much until it does, you know, there are a few things I can say about this. Regardless of what people are saying, the first and most important thing is this decision isn't a loss. You know, all of our licensors' patents, you know, the asserted patents in the litigation, they were found to be infringed, and two of the licensors were awarded an accounting. You know, in the German system, that allows them to recover damages. The next thing, you know, it's true that the court decided not to issue an injunction, you know, but this was based on a narrow issue. The rest of the program's terms were upheld as FRAND. You know, the issue is how we and other pools, you know, how we address royalties owed under multiple licenses for the same technology for those licensees and licensors that are in both pools. You know, the royalties owed by licensees that are in both pools, we refer to those as duplicate royalties because they're royalties paid on the same patents that are common to that are in both pools to those common licensors in both pools. You know, our policy followed long-term industry practice, you know, and in fact, it went beyond what other pools have traditionally done to address the issue. You know, this practice in the past has been that the licensees and licensors that are in both pools determine which pool the licensee will pay and which it won't. Okay. You know, this is because the two parties, that know what's happening for both license agreements for the licensee and licensor that are in both pools. And the pool administrator only knows what's happening with its pool. You know, even so, you know, the German court felt that we, the pool administrator, needed to take additional steps to assure that licensors in both pools don't receive duplicate royalties. The court said that the pool administrator should have a contractual commitment to licensees to assure that they don't, that the licensors, you know, won't receive duplicate royalties, licensees won't pay duplicate royalties, rather than the licensees themselves having to address the issue with the licensors that are in both pools. You know, again, how the issue of duplicate royalties is addressed is an industry practice. So we feel pretty strongly that this decision doesn't just apply to Advance. You know, the good news is that this decision provides guidance on how to address the issue moving forward. And we've already updated our program to reflect the court's reasoning. You know, like you mentioned, we issued a press release yesterday now announcing how Advance and its licensors will handle duplicate royalties going forward. It's posted on our website and we invite people to read it and contact us if they have any questions. You know, it's also good news because, you know, some companies have been using this as an issue and an excuse not to take a license from us, but that's now been resolved, so they won't be able to do it anymore. So, you know, regardless of what some early commentators are saying out there and that they're calling it a loss and a setback, it's not. It's progress, and because the result's going to be better pools.
Well, that's good to hear. I mean, if it's improving the system, that is great. Can you maybe in a nutshell summarize what that change is that you did and that you announced yesterday?
Well, it's a little bit complex. So I would prefer to have people read our press release and contact us. But it's like I said, it basically gives us as a licensing administrator an obligation to make sure the licensors are only receiving one royalty. And in certain circumstances, it will automatically have us do what we call pre-netting. In other words, deduct the amount that licensor would receive from that licensee from the invoice in advance so that there's no royalties. Now, in some cases, it may not be our pool that makes the deduction. It may be another pool.
Right.
So that's where complexity comes in, and it's, you know, not to get into too much of it here. We just invite anybody to contact us and go through it because, the situations are different for licensees.
True.
So, what works for one may not be the best for other. It's just that they know that they're not only going to pay once.
Okay. Well, I understand that. And I guess then the ruling basically said that you are responsible to make sure that happens, right? So.
Right. Well, the licensors have a responsibility too. But, you know, before we didn't have a contractual obligation, we kind of thought we did, but the court decided we didn't was written. So we just clarified that and put a better policy in place to make sure that licensees are informed and can make their choice.
One last question on this overlap. Is that also going to be happening a lot with VVC, with the latest codec, or do we have probably less overlap there?
There's going to be a lot of overlap in licensors between at least our HEVC program and VVC program. This is for a couple reasons. The companies both participated in the development of both pools. And, we think that there's about a 35% overlap in HEVC essential patents that are also going to be essential to VVC. But then again, there are going to be several licensors that aren't, VVC licensors that aren't in our HEVC pool because, at least right now, they don't have HEVC patents. Some of these companies, they didn't participate in the development of HEVC. And, like I said, some of them weren't even in existence at the time HEVC was formed. Companies are forming, some companies are joining pools for the first time. Pools are a choice for both licensees and licensors. A licensor doesn't have to join, any pool just because it's in one other pool where patents might overlap. So again, this goes to the business interest and reaching those long-term goals for every licensee, and licensor. You have to let companies make their choices that are in their best interest. And we work hard to help get them to understand why it's in their best interest to join our pool and the best interest of the overall market. But, again, it's their choice.
Right. That was really enlightening, Paul. Thank you so much for your comments, your thoughts on all these very complex licensing issues. My last question is always, your elevator pitch, your 1 or 2 minute last statement on what you want our listeners to keep remembering from you and from maybe the world of pool licensing and the video codec world.
Yeah, sure. Well, first, thanks for the opportunity to join you and your audience today on the podcast. This has been great. It's been a lot of fun. Let me just touch a little bit on one thing quickly that we didn't touch on, which is one of the things we've done in our new program is create a scalable platform. And so licensees that are in both our HEVC Advance pool and our VVC Advance pool have the opportunity, it's an option, it's not a requirement, they get to choose what's best for them, but to sign a separate agreement that we call the multi-codec bridging agreement. It's not a license, it's an administrative agreement that takes these next generation's pools, that are scalable and puts them together so that licensees have a single place to do all the reporting for products that have only HEVC or only VVC or include both VVC and HEVC. It allows them to put consolidated, patent marking and trademark logos and things. So the administrative burdens are very much simplified. And it also creates some very significant discounts for companies' products that have both HEVC and VVC implemented in them. So, this will allow our licensors in the future to add even more video formats. They take the MCBA, they look at its structure, they create a new royalty structure for it. And when a licensee decides to add a new technology, if we have a pool to that, then they'll, again, all this efficient structure that's allowed through the MCBA for administrative purposes and royalty discounts, it'll flow through to them. So it builds. We think this is a pretty new and very important implementation in pool structure. That's what we heard and all that feedback from people early on in the VVC processes. You got to fix this. And that's what we think we've done. So, we invite people to contact us and ask us about it, and ask people who know us. I think they're going to tell you that we listen carefully to all sides, from big and small implementers and big and small licensors. We appreciate the opportunity to address reasonable issues, and we're going to continue to study the marketplace and work closely with our licensors to address market issues in market conditions. We hope that licensors and licensees are going to contact us to learn more, The one thing we promise everybody is to earn your business and your trust. And we're going to do that initially and over the long term. So we hope that they'll contact us. Tim, thanks a lot for today. It was great being here.
Same here, Paul. This is really great. This was Paul Bawel, Senior VP President with Access Advance. Paul, thank you so much for your thoughts, picking up your mind today, and all these great answers. Very exciting. Thanks for having, thanks for taking part in this, and thanks for being here.
Thanks, Tim.